Welcome again to another episode of Simple Truth Sabbath School. I'm your host, Chuck Austin, and with me today I have Pastor Edward Nelson of the Grants Pass Seventh-day Adventist Church. Nice to have you here, Pastor.
Glad to be here.
And also we have Pastor Sean Murphy, who is the pastor of the Turning Point and the Glide Church.
Glad to be here.
Thank you. So we are, as you may know if you've been following along with us, we're on Lesson 4, and we've been doing the Great Controversy. The Great Controversy, which I think is in this world we can see that there is definitely a controversy between good and evil going on for sure.
Yeah.
And Lesson 4 is standing for the truth. You know, we need people that are willing to stand for the truth in these days where darkness seems to be overshadowing this world. Before beginning the lesson, we always like to pray and make sure that we are asking the Holy Spirit to be here with us. So Pastor Nelson, could you pray for us?
Be glad to. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your love, and we thank you for the light that shines from your word. We ask that your Spirit would open our minds to your message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So let me read the memory text on the Sabbath afternoon lesson. It says, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Which is interesting. That's John 13, 14, and 15, which just precedes the most popular verse in the Bible, John 3, 16. And this was Jesus talking, just for a reference point here, was talking to Nicodemus, one of the Jewish leaders, and was relating to him, just as Moses needed to be lifted up, lifting up the serpent in the wilderness, so must Jesus himself be lifted up, that he would draw humanity to him,
yep,
all mankind. All right, let's look at the second and third paragraph here. It says, "Once a year, all the citizens of Smyrna were commanded to burn incense to the Roman gods." And Smyrna was a city there in Asia Minor, a very populous city. Evidently, in the second century, Smyrna had a thriving Christian community as well, and many were not going to comply. Polycarp, an early church leader, was martyred in Smyrna's public square, burned at the stake for refusing to betray his Lord by burning incense to the Roman gods. When asked one last time to disavow Christ, the old man replied, 86 years I have served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I speak evil of my King who saved me?" Throughout the centuries, men and women have been willing to experience martyrdom rather than give up their faith in Christ. Their sacrifice rekindles our courage. The story of their commitment to Christ renews our own commitment. And how true is that? That, you know, we read of those that have stood for truth and have been willing to sacrifice with their own lives, the courage it's given others through time, and hopefully it's giving us courage as well.
Mm-hmm. I think that one for me is we don't accept Christ for the sake of dying, necessarily, literally physically dying. But the idea is, if we die to self, you know, like Paul says, I die daily. If in fact I'm dying to self, and there comes a point in time to wearing the title of the lesson, Standing for Truth, if it comes to denying the Lord and his truth and not, then at that point in time, then if I've died to self, I would be willing to die for him rather than deny him and his truth.
Mm-hmm. And the grace, and that God gives us the grace we need when we need it.
Amen.
Yeah. We don't need, there's nobody coming in through the door right there and putting a gun to our head and saying, you either deny Christ. You know, so we don't need that grace now, but we do need that grace. When we do need that grace, God will give it to us at that time.
That's right.
Yeah. I remember watching, it was actually a black and white movie, so it was a relatively old movie, John Huss, who was a reformer, and it was the closing scene in that movie that I'm going to refer to here, and he was sitting in a dungeon because he was not going to deny Jesus, and he was going to be burned at the stake the next day. And so in the scene there, it shows him like down this dark dungeon, and he's got a rickety old wooden table, and there's one single candle there, and he has like a one of these, a pen, I think it was, or a writing utensil, and was writing on a scroll. And then you see him, he actually stops and sits back and pauses, and he's looking at the candle, And then he takes his hand and he puts it over the candle and then he pulls back. Mm-hmm. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, he was probably thinking, what's it going to be like tomorrow when I get burned at the stake? What's it going to feel like? But God gave him the grace to be able to do what he needed to do at that time.
Right. So. Well, we even see that with Jesus. You know, he's in the garden and he's wrestling and he's praying, Father, you know, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. But he adds, as you mentioned, Sean, you know, he's willing to die to self. Nevertheless, not my will be done, but your will. And God sends an angel to strengthen Jesus, fortifying him to go through, you know, and presenting before him, you know, what the result would be. God would be honored and glorified. You know, everyone that believes in him would have eternal life with him. Amen. And he sets his face to, you know, to do his Father's will, which is pretty amazing. But you're right. In the moment, you know, we don't have that grace, you know, until we need it.
Right. Amen. Yeah. Amen. All right. Well, let's go into Sunday's lesson. It says, persecuted yet triumphant. Okay. And I want to read a couple passages here. I'm going to ask Pastor Sean to read Daniel 7, verses 24 and 25, and Pastor Nelson, if you could read verses right, follow on the heels of that, read in Revelation 12, verses 6 and 14.
So Daniel 7, 24, the 10 horns are 10 kings who shall arise from this kingdom, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue 3 kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saint shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time.
So Revelation 12, 6, then the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. And verse 14 says, but the woman was given 2 wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent.
Okay, so we see some time references here, time, times, and half a time. And when we do a study on that, you realize that that is equivalent to the earlier passage read, 1,260 days. And we know from Bible prophecy that there is passages in the Bible that gives us the understanding that a day equals a year in Bible prophecy. Numbers 14:34 and Ezekiel 4:6 are 2 references, and maybe some other ones as well. Those are the 2 I'm familiar with. But we see that there is a definite time frame, 1,260 years actually. So it says 1,260 days, but we know a day for year principle. 1,260 years that God's people were being persecuted. And it was, again, further study, you find out that was time to time what we call the Dark Ages. Mm-hmm. And it was dark. Why? Because the light of God's truth was kept hidden. And unfortunately, the church, the visible church at that time was corrupt and was being compromising truth.
So the one thing that, so last lesson we talked about how subtle Satan is with some of his things that he tries to bring in, whether it be compromise or just simply being too busy to read his word and things like that. But when that doesn't work, he gets really, really, really enraged, pretty much. And so the idea of us being faithful, I really believe that is what is driving this thing called the Great Controversy, is that he wants everybody to turn from God. That's his goals. And God says, no, I want everybody to turn to me. But he says, I want it to be from love and relationship versus threat of persecution and or death that comes from this side. And when we see that as contrast, I think that should be part of a big part of our motivation, seeing the contrast. Yeah, you know, I'm going to promise you the sun, moon, and stars, but once you're there, and if you ever try to leave, we can look at mission stories, and if you ever try to leave that kingdom, there's a price to pay for trying to leave that kingdom. And he's more than willing to persecute as far as he needs to. if he was able to, I think he would actually inflict death on whoever it is that mm-hmm. would walk away. But I really, the lesson, the idea, yes, we are persecuted, but yet through the merits of Christ, triumphant.
Amen. Mm-hmm. The stories that come out of there, like you said, is some of these people that were spirit worshipers and ancestor worship and stuff, when they decided to come out, you know, mm-hmm. they had been worshiping demons unknowingly. And to come out of that, boy, there is definitely a great battle that goes
yes.
on.
Yes. You know, I wanted to also highlight another thing. This is Revelation chapter 6, where the souls under the altar that had been slain for the word of God and the testimony which they held, they cry out to God. This is Revelation 6:10. They cry out with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? And I like the answer because it says, then a white robe was given to each of them, and that they should rest a little while longer. And that white robe represents the righteousness of Christ. It represents holiness and purity. And they said, rest a little while longer. Mm-hmm. You know, God is going to overturn what has been done. He's going to avenge them, and he's also going to reward them. And that white robe is a symbol of the assurance that their lives are hidden with Christ, which is a wonderful thought yeah. when we think of, you know, as a matter of fact, it's very interesting that there were many times during the Dark Ages when people were going to be burned at the stake that women would don a wedding dress mm-hmm. to go be burned at the stake. And they were saying, today I'm going to be, you know, after I die, and some of them didn't understand, you know, the state of the dead and some of these kinds of things, but it was like, today I'm going to be with Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, that was their attitude. Mm-hmm. I'm going to stay faithful to him, and as a result, I know that he will raise me up at the resurrection, mm-hmm. and I will mm-hmm. be with him.
Mm-hmm. And that's the triumph.
That is the triumph.
Yeah.
Yep. The affliction they had to go through then was nothing compared to the glory that would be when they be with Jesus.
That's
for
right.
all eternity.
Praise the
yeah.
Lord.
Yep. Yeah. So here on Sunday's lesson, this first paragraph says, Whenever God's people remain faithful to him, Satan is enraged. And you brought that out, John. Persecution often follows. The prophet Daniel described a time still future to him when the medieval church would make war against and persecute God's people. The prophet John described this same period as a time when God's church would be forced to flee into the wilderness, where she would be nourished for a time and times and half a time. And Revelation 12:6 adds, the woman or the church, when you study that out, you'll realize that woman symbolically can represent a church, fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God. God's people were nourished in the wilderness. His word strengthened and sustained them as the great controversy raged on during this long and dark period of papal domination. And then couple paragraphs down, it explains again that the 1260 days and time, times and half of times are both referring to the same time period, which we talked about.
I really like something about that, the idea of that little phrase, a place prepared. Because if you take that to the story of Jonah, God prepared A, then God prepared, and the whole idea behind it was so that God's message would go out. And the thing is to Jonah, the message was, here comes destruction. But with God, the message was, if you don't, Jonah declared it, in 40 days, Nineveh will be destroyed. Mm-hmm. But the underlying thought process, I believe, from God was, I really don't want to destroy you. So if you would just turn from that, and I believe that all of this, God prepared A, all of that is intended to have people spoken to of a God who really wants them just to turn mm-hmm. in his direction. And that's the whole thing. When we see that, that's when the kingdom of Satan takes a large, large hit. Because we actually see a God who's not saying, I'm all about destruction. No, he's all about redemption. And everything that he does is aimed at that. And of course, if Satan could confuse us as to that, oh man, he's really achieved an awful lot, because now we're confused as to the character mm-hmm. of our Creator.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's why the Word of God is so important. That's why these individuals were willing to take the stand that they were, It was because they understood and they had some knowledge of the Word of God. Not everyone had a Bible at that time, but many of those who were willing to take a stand took a stand on the truth that came to them through the Word of God.
Yeah.
And that made the difference.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah. And remember, like I said, God's ultimate plan for everyone is salvation. Mm-hmm. And he's working to that end, and he's going to work his plans. His thoughts and ways are so much higher than ours. Well, we don't see sometime how he's working. It can confuse us, perplex us and stuff. But God's ultimate plan is to save everyone, and he's going to implement and prepare his plan in order to do that.
Amen.
All right, Sean, if you could read John 16:2. And this is amazing verse in regards to what people that are claiming to be religious will do to those that are God's people.
They will put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think that he offers God service.
Yeah. So Jesus said they'll put you out of the synagogue. In other words, they'll put you out of the churches. So these are people that are religious people that are going to kick you out of the church, and then they're going to kill you, and they're thinking they're doing God's work because they're seeing that you are the heretic. You are the one that is in rebellion against God when it's really the opposite. Mm-hmm. And that makes me think of that verse in Isaiah where it says that there's going to come a time where people are going to call good evil and evil good, mm-hmm. and sweet for bitter and bitter for sweet. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to see some of that in our society today, where we know from the Bible what the Bible teaches about morality and truth is now being flip-flopped completely around.
Right. Well, and I like that verse because God is, through Jesus, is sharing with us that persecution is coming. And so when it does come, it's not, to those who've listened to Jesus' word, it's not alarming. It's like Jesus said this would happen. He said if we remain faithful, we would be persecuted. And, the question is sometimes asked, why aren't we being persecuted today? Well, because we might not be as faithful as we should be. Mm-hmm. Jesus foretold that this persecution would come, but he also said that those who endure to the end will be saved.
Amen. So the question asked about at the bottom of Sunday's lesson, the question asked there in the pink box, so put you guys on the spot here. How has fulfilled Bible prophecy strengthened your faith? Any thoughts there?
Yeah, for me, I was in high school and we were studying world religions, and the thought dawned on me, I was probably 17, 18 years old, I could have been born anywhere and to any parents, and whoever they were and whatever they believed would be what they would teach me. And all of a sudden, I didn't know what truth was. Because if that was true, then my parents, who had been teaching me the Bible, that doesn't necessarily make the Bible, and I had been receiving it from them. And so it disturbed me. It's like my whole world was kind of flipped upside down. And as I started studying other religions and studying, the thing that brought me back to the Bible was that when I recognized that there was very little prophecy in the other holy books, and verses that could be constrained as prophetic were so shadowy. It's like, is this talking about what the guy ate for breakfast this morning, or is this talking about World War III? You know, like you read some of what Nostradamus has written, and only like 10% or something they say has been fulfilled. But you read it, and it's like, it's nothing like Bible prophecy. Bible prophecy is specific. It drills down. It gives names. It tells you exactly when things are going to happen. And I was acquainted with some of that. And that's what brought me right back to, I was like, if there's a God, and he is God, then he can tell the future. None of us can tell the future. Mm-hmm. And the only book that I knew of that had prophecy and that was fulfilled was this book. Mm-hmm. So it just steeled in my mind, this is the truth. My parents have not been feeding me cunningly devised fables. Right. This is true. Mm-hmm. History's been fulfilled and shown it to be true. And so for me, it was an amazing thing. And I was very fortunate to, I think, be steered in that direction at that age.
Mm-hmm. Go, you want to say something?
So there's a few things, kind of just jumping off of that. And that is because it says, how has fulfilled Bible prophecy strengthened your faith? Because there has never been anything that God has prophesied himself directly or through a prophet that has ever failed. Mm. And so how can that strengthen my faith today? Because a God who's never failed in that has promised that he will never fail me personally. Mm. And I think that is the big strengthener of my faith, the idea that we are being told the truth and we're being steered in the right direction. Absolutely. But it's today. It's something to where he says, not only do I not fail in the over 300 prophecies just for the Messiah to come the first time, perfectly fulfilled, everything that Jesus did so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And then he says, that's for you. I won't fail you either. And it's just like, oh, wow. Mm-hmm. And he wants us to understand that all of that stuff is just not simply to be able to say, I'm pretty powerful, huh? No, it's to actually say, I want you to see that I will fulfill everything that I have said, everything that I promised in you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd say for me, it would be exactly similar to what you said, Pastor Nelson, was that when I, especially Daniel 2, when I saw Daniel 2 and saw how the prophecy of the image and the different nations, how they were fulfilled, and Daniel shared these in advance.
Right.
And I mean, he didn't, you know, this was going to happen years after he lived, and yet it came true. And that confirmed in me that mm-hmm. the Bible is true. In fact, I've shared that with people that I maybe even felt relatives and stuff that maybe haven't shown a lot of interest in the Bible. I said, you just read Daniel chapter 2, just read one chapter, and then ask yourself, how did Daniel know all this mm-hmm. going to happen? Unless there was some divine intelligence that was giving him special information ahead mm-hmm. of time. Because mm-hmm. he couldn't have figured that out.
Right. Well, and the beautiful thing about that is that the Bible has also prophesied what will be. That God's people may go through difficulty, challenge, persecution, martyrdom. But on the other side, he's promised, I will never leave you or forsake you through that. And on the other side, you'll wear a crown. Amen. If you're faithful, you will wear a crown and you'll live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years.
Amen. Amen.
And the idea of, you know, Daniel chapter 2, Daniel actually got to witness the first two fulfillments. Mm-hmm. Because I mean he was Babylon, he was Media and Persia. Mm-hmm. So he actually got to see them, and it's like, oh wow. Just the first two were fulfilled. Even that's amazing.
Yeah. Right.
But in faith, he went ahead and wrote it down, because if God could actually be faithful with Babylon and Media of Persia, then I think he'd definitely be faithful with Greece and Rome.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just read recently, it was earlier this week, that some people are saying that that Daniel didn't really, some Bible teachers and stuff of universities and stuff are saying, well, Daniel didn't really live that time. You know, because how could he have known that? Mm-hmm. So he actually, and this is interesting, these are Bible professors, you know, but they said that he probably wrote it in around the second century BC. And so my thought to that is, okay, well, if that's true, let's just suppose it's true just for now anyway, even though I don't believe it's true, that he wrote about Babylon, Greece, Medo-Persia, Greece, and he saw the beginning of Rome. You know, because if it's 150 BC, we know that Rome conquered Greece around 168 BC. So he saw Rome just coming into power. How did he know that? Because your obvious prediction then would be that 1, 2, 3, 4 kingdoms, there's going to be a fifth kingdom that's going to conquer Rome. How did he know that there would not be a fifth kingdom, but it was going to spread out into 10 different tribes? How did he know that?
Right.
Exactly, because there was divine inspiration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, let's go on to Monday's lesson. We're zipping right along here. A light vanquishes the darkness. And so, Pastor Nelson, if you could read Jude verses 3 and 4.
Yes, beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men, who turn the grace of our God into lewdness and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ.
All right. And then, Pastor Sean, if you could read 2 Peter 2, verses 1 and 2.
But there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed.
Okay. So in both those passages that you read, we're seeing both the authors warning their people, their audience, that there are people that are ungodly men that are going to be bringing in untruth, that are going to be trying to lead you astray. And in their minds, they're going to be thinking they're leading you into truth. Mm. Right. But sadly to say, they're, because of their wrong understanding, they're going to be actually leading you away from truth.
Mm-hmm. 1 Timothy chapter 4 says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons." And in 2 Thessalonians 2, Paul continues with this, is there's going to come a great apostasy in the church. Mm-hmm. And the dark age is the 1,260 days that we mentioned. It starts in 538 to 1798, was a time where those that were in the visible organized church were, as Paul says here, were heeding deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. And as a result, great darkness settled on the Christian world. There was mm-hmm. persecution. The truth was kept out of sight. God's word, they did not want God's word to be kept, to be brought forth. So they locked it in a foreign language where people couldn't have access to it. And anyone that was found with the Bible was, killed, and those things were confiscated. They were burned. But Paul says that this is going to happen. And that ungodly men are going to creep into the church, according to Jude. That's exactly what happened.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. It's interesting that in that passage it says they will depart from the faith, right. Which means they must have been in the faith at one time, because
right.
you can't depart from something if you're not in it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and that's what Jude says, that ungodly men have crept into the church.
Right.
You know, and this is the only, right here, and we ourselves, when Paul preached, Paul, who was doing miracles, who was just an amazing guy, who, I just imagine the way the churches would receive Paul coming to their church. Mm-hmm. Paul's here, we're going to go hear him. But when the Bereans listened to what Paul preached, they said, we're not going to accept that unless we find it confirmed here.
Right.
And that's where we need to be. Or we could be misled, and deceived, because Satan is constantly looking to deceive. That's why we need to be in our Bibles. We need to study for ourselves. We need to ask the Holy Spirit, lead me into all truth.
Right. That makes me think of my very first Sabbath as a pastor, which was just a touch over a year ago. There was I said something, and someone said, that's a good thought. And this lady goes, where'd you get that from? And I said, I can't tell you chapter and verse. And so she goes, I'm going to have to check you out, like that, out of the corner of her eye. And I said to her, absolutely. From this point forward, check out everything that I say. Mm-hmm. And she looks over. And then things went on, and she reached over, and she went, I was just kidding. I looked at her. I said, I know, but still check me out.
That's right.
Yeah. That's right. And I've shared that with my Bible study students. I've done a number of Bible studies, early into our series that we go through and stuff. Within the first couple lessons, I'll if I can think about it, do the first one, but sometimes I don't think about it until the second or third one. But I share with them very much similar thought. I said, and don't believe anything because I say it. It's because when you stand before the Lord someday, you're not going to say, well, Chuck seems like such a nice guy, and boy, right. he knew how to go to Bible verse, Bible verse, and so I just believe what he was saying. No. If there's something that I say, something that doesn't sound quite right to you, that causes you to, to question, I said, have me show it from the Bible. Have me share that principle from the Bible, because, it's got to be the Word of God that has to be our foundation, what a person says.
That's right.
All right. So it says here in Monday's lesson, it says, the book of Jude was written sometime before AD 65 to faithful Christians who were sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ. That's from Jude 1:1. These faithful believers were urged to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who turned the grace of our God into lewdness. This admonition means even more to believers in the Middle Ages, after pagan practices had flooded into the church and human traditions compromised the Word of God. For many centuries, people such as the Waldenses stood as champions for the truths of Scripture. They believed that Christ was their only mediator and the Bible their sole source of authority. In every age, there were witnesses for God, men who cherished faith in Christ as their only mediator between God and man, who held the Bible as the only rule of life and hallowed the true Sabbath. And that, it's so true. I have a book by J.A. Wiley. Maybe some have heard of or read it. Yeah, he's an author back in the 1800s, and he wrote a book called The History of the Waldenses. Powerful book of these people group that were living in the recesses of the Alp Mountains and stuff. And they were, because as you shared, Pastor, that people that were found with a Bible during those times, they were taken and if not killed, at least thrown into prison for long times. Yes. And these people would go and they would take little portions of Scripture and they would hide them on themselves. And then at times when they could tell somebody that was open to the gospel, they would leave something. Many times they'd leave it to them unknowingly. They would, if they'd, you know, because they were sell wares along the way, pottery or whatever they were selling, clothing or whatever, they would leave a little bit hidden in whatever their product was that they sold, so that that person would find it later and be able to read it. So, yeah.
I think that in the modern day, if we asked ourselves the question, is the Word of God that meaningful to us? Is it something that we would be willing to risk? They risked an awful lot to do what they did, because if any of that, if that transaction was seen, or it, this little piece of paper was traced back to them or anything like that, and they said absolutely, positively, it's worth every bit of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They loved not their lives to the death.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
It was free.
Yeah.
Amen.
Their whole desire was to share with others the joy that they had found in Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that, and it should be a joy that we have in Jesus, you know.
Yes.
All right, let's look at Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. Pastor Nelson, if you could read that.
Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life.
Amen. And so the question it asks here, it says, what promise does God give those who are faithful to him in the face of death itself? Mm-hmm. And we said, when you mentioned, you read it, the crown of life. You know, that's, that is a greater gift than anything we could ever have on this earth.
This verse right here was one of the verses that the Waldensians took very personally. Mm-hmm. And this was written in their churches, and they, you know, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. And many of them lay down their lives, and whole entire villages were destroyed by marching armies that came up into northern Italy, southern France, to try and destroy them. And many times they did. There was 3,000 people that lost their lives at one time. Another time there was like 200 people that they hid in a cave, and then they built a giant fire and just killed everyone with the smoke. But these people were faithful, and it was the Word of God that sustained them. This promise from Jesus, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. That promise, along with all the other promises, what sustained them to be able to be faithful to Jesus in a very difficult time.
And I think we need to focus on the proper part of that verse, because we don't need to focus on to death. We need to focus on to life.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And so the idea is, regardless of anything that goes on, it's the crown of life that we're looking forward to. Death may be the part of it. Under sin, death is going to be a part of it. Would we die before the second coming of Christ? In what way? That to me is secondary to, but I'm living under the assurance of the crown of life.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Yep. Very good. Well, let's go on to Tuesday's lesson, Courage to Stand. Okay. And Pastor Sean, if you could read Acts 5, 28 to 32. And then right on the heels of that, Pastor Nelson, if you could read Ephesians 6, verses 10 to 12. And then we'll talk about those two verses, those passages.
Saying, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood on us. But Peter and other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Him God has exalted to his right hand to be Prince and Savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are his witnesses to these things. And so also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him.
All right, thank you. And then also, Pastor Nelson's Ephesians 6, 10 to 12.
Yes. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places.
So, looking at those two passages, what is the being brought out in those two passages, do you think? It jumps out. Anything jump out at you there?
I really like in your passage, Sean, we ought to obey God rather than men.
Yeah. So if we keep going, which we didn't read it word for word, but Gamaliel being a very wise man, he says, now listen, what we're about to do is something we need to very, very seriously consider, because if this is of man, it's going to end up like all the rest of these things. They rose up, to use a modern term, they had some charisma and stuff like that, but all of those just went away. But if we find ourselves fighting against God, mm-hmm. and I'll just stop there, if we find ourselves fighting against God, and so do you think in their minds, and I was going to bring it out, so thank you for bringing it out, because we ought to obey God rather than men. Now the religious leaders had to actually make a decision. Mm-hmm. Are these guys actually obeying God? And Gamaliel said, if in fact they are obeying God, we could find ourselves literally in a fight with God himself.
Yeah. Which is not a good place to be.
No.
Right. And when you look at the outcome of what happened in the first century, those that were fighting against, whether it be in the Jewish nation or whether it be in the Roman Empire, they passed. But the Church of Jesus has prevailed and continued. During the Dark Ages, those who are upholding the truths of the Word of God, though they were being slaughtered, some accounts say 100 million during those 1,260 years could have been slaughtered by the medieval church. Mm-hmm. But Christ's word prevailed. The Reformation came forth. The truths that were found in the Word of God were presented before the people, and eventually light overcame darkness.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, we've always had a thread, a people group that God's had a thread always throughout history. Even when it seems like the truth was snuffed out, the light was struck, God had his people like the Waldenses,
right,
the Huguenots, that were preserving truth.
Amen.
So, and going to the passage you read, the only way that, going off of the title of the lesson, the only way we can have that courage to stand is if we actually have the equipment that only God can provide.
Amen.
Which is his armor.
Amen.
And so how is it that the Waldensians were able to stand? How is it that Huss and Jerome were able to stand?
Yes.
How is it that, I mean, we can just keep going with all the throughout all of human history and Christian history specifically. How is it that they made sure that they were equipped the way God says, this is the only way that you can have the courage to stand, would be to be equipped this way.
Amen.
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 Ben, you also read there about our battle isn't with flesh and blood, you know. That, you know, sometimes we get upset with a certain person because certain, I mean, we got to realize that Satan's using that situation to try to cause me to misrepresent who Jesus is, you know. And so again, it comes down, and it's not easy. I mean, I wish I could say that, oh yeah, I recognize it all the time, and I respond the way Jesus responded all the time. But that's the one thing I want to have the Lord work with me on, and reminding me that, Chuck, this isn't about, you know, this confrontation with the person, this is about, are you going to represent my character?
Yeah.
And if you're willing to, and that calls for humility. Mm-hmm. And we as human beings are not, it's not a natural trait in us to exhibit humility.
Right.
We have to die to self and let go of pride so that Jesus can shine through, mm-hmm. Yeah. Which is amazing. Here's Jesus, the King of the universe. And yet in Matthew 11, Jesus says, "For I am meek and lowly in heart." In some versions, it says, you know, that I'm meek and humble in heart. And you think of Jesus. I mean, here's the God of the universe, the one that doesn't really need to be humble, the mm-hmm. one that created everything. And yet he says, that's one of my characteristics, mm-hmm. is humility.
So. Yeah.
Amen.
Good point.
Yeah. All right. In the first paragraph here, it says, one of the distinguishing characteristics of the Waldensians and each of one of the reformers was their absolute allegiance to God, their obedience to the authority of Scripture, and their commitment to the supremacy of Christ, not the papacy. Their minds were saturated with New Testament stories of faith and courage. It says, with Peter and the apostles, they could say, we ought to obey God rather than men. They grasped Paul's admonition, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. They took seriously Jesus' counsel, hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. Rather than submit to the traditions of the Roman Church, these stalwart men and women of faith had the courage to stand for the truth of God's word. Mm-hmm. And that's true truth. You know, we need to hold fast that no one may take our crown, mm-hmm. because Satan is going to do everything he can to try to bring people in to cause us to question God or to just sow seeds of doubt in about maybe our own personal experience. So you call yourself a Christian, and so we got to realize that our salvation is not in anything we can do. Our salvation is in what Jesus has already done for us.
Amen.
There's something that is really key, because you know we're bringing up the Roman Church, and it's something where history just simply, it's just a sad truth of history of what it is that the Roman Church was capable of. But I'll personalize it. It was written, and I believe it was in a sermon form. But it was the title, I'll never forget it, was called The Roman Within. Mm-hmm. And it was something where all of us, if we don't equip ourselves with the Word of God, mm-hmm. and we don't have His level of humility, then we could become a one-man wrecking crew mm-hmm. of Romanism.
Right.
And what does that look like within the church? That's right. The thing. What does that look like within the church? It's me coming in and every little thing I want to argue about, and I want to prove myself right, and all this stuff like that. What does that look like? If the humility of the Lord comes in, I can actually have some form of difference with somebody and still come out of the situation with a level of respect. So the thing is we have to be very careful not just to say, well, the Roman Church.
Yes.
What we have to do is we have to say, Lord, help me not to become the Roman Church as an individual. Mm-hmm. I literally could become a one-man wrecking crew of a church.
Mm-hmm. I like what you're bringing out here. The thought that comes to my mind, the thought that departed from my mind, where was I going? I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. That's okay. Well, while you're sharing that, or you think about that, say that passage, like you said, because that person that allows that kind of mindset to be in it, it's my opinion was what matters,
yeah.
and you mm-hmm. need to accept my opinion. And when we are not open to be teachable, that's when it becomes very dangerous in our own Christian
yes.
experience. We're not
yes.
teachable. Right.
Well, and I remember now. There was a time when Jesus was sending his disciples forward to the places where he was going to go, and there was a Samaritan town that rejected Jesus mm-hmm. and says, we don't want him. Mm-hmm. And James and John says, Lord, shall we bring fire down on that town?
Yeah, good
They're
idea.
Not accepting the truth. They're not accepting you. Let's just judge them right now. And Jesus is like, you know, the Son of Man didn't come into the world to have men lose their lives. Mm-hmm. I came to save men's lives. You don't know what spirit you're of mm-hmm. in saying this. And the church in Jesus' day was so intent on controlling the narrative, so intent on maintaining orthodoxy the way they defined it, they were willing to whip and scourge and crucify and kill anyone who didn't go. Like, whenever we pick up force, you know, to try and either in our family or in the church or in any public way, whenever we're out with pitchforks and torches, we're of the wrong spirit. It is not anything that the Lord can bless.
Amen. Amen.
So then, in to frame that as a question, how can we know of what spirit we are of? Mm. How can we know that? Well, if we have any of that stuff that you just mentioned, if we have any of that, up to and including, Lord, can I call fire on them? We can understand that it's not the Holy Spirit that's not in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So how can we understand what spirit we're of? By way of how we end up with our fellow men and how it is that we get along with each other.
One of the ways that, one of the litmus tests for me that the Lord has brought back to me through my wife, to my mind, that sometimes I'll be upset about something that may be happening in the church or may be happening in the world, and I'm not happy with an individual that's doing, you know, something, and the Lord is kind of knocking on the door of my heart, are you praying for that individual? And a lot of times, I'm not. When I'm so irritated with something that they're doing that I disagree with, and I'm not praying for them. You look at Daniel and how he dealt with Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was, I mean, he was a tyrant. He was a dictator, absolute. And yet Daniel's praying for the king, you know? Like, Daniel sees in chapter 4 that the king is going to get cut down and he's going to be brought down to size. And he's not like, all right, God, that now it's time for him to get what he deserves. No. He's like, no, don't, let's not do this, king. You know, repent from your sins that God may show mercy to you. That's the spirit that that Christ has. That's the spirit that all his apostles and prophets have had. That's the spirit that we need to be in praying for others.
And there's a little something there too. We have to make sure we don't pray at them.
Yes.
We pray for them.
Yes.
Because I could actually say, and Lord, take that dictator out. Well, I'm praying.
Right.
I'm praying. But no, Lord, please turn that dictator's heart.
Right.
Now there's a difference between praying at and praying for.
Right. Mm-hmm. Correct.
Right. And the thing is too, is we realize, like you said, James and John wanted to just take them out. Let's minister justice right now, Lord, because they're defying you and stuff. And that's the beautiful thing about God. God is long-suffering.
Amen.
In fact, 2 Peter 3:15 says that the long-suffering of our God is salvation. If God wasn't so long-suffering with us, there wouldn't be any salvation with there.
Thank God for that.
And so He is administering mercy upon us. As He sees us, He knows that we are but dust. He knows, you know, how much we mess up again and again and again and again and again. And He just continues to be long-suffering and show mercy to us. Now, there is going to come a time where God will administer justice when we have rejected so long that we finally closed the door and bolted it 10 times that, God, there's nothing you can show me that I want to know about you. I'm so closed that there's nothing that God realizes that point. At that point, then God steps back and allows maybe justice to take its place at that point.
Mm-hmm. And I think you actually, that last little bit is really key. God allows, mm-hmm. or another way of putting God's wrath into a phrase, God gave them up to.
Right.
He finally just said, I've been trying to show you plan A for your life for this long. And He finally goes, I don't want to do this, but I'm going to give you up to what it is that you've been saying you want. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to honor your choice. There's people that think the wrath of God is just this pointed, really, really arbitrary. No, it's just God simply saying, I want so bad to be in your life and so bad to mold and shape everything into just this amazing experience with me and you. Mm-hmm. But you've said you want nothing to do with it. And He goes, And I believe that the posture is, oh, I don't want to do this. Mm-hmm. And that's how the justice comes forth. It's God just simply allows for a respecting of choice, even though He doesn't really, he can see clearly that it's just not the best choice.
Mm-hmm. Right. And in the book of Ezekiel, it brings out that when God does eventually, when this is all over, does bring His final execution of the sentence, it says, it calls it a strange act.
Strange act, yeah.
Because he's creator. He's not destroyer. So it's a strange act for God to have to destroy his own creation. But he does that for the best of the best interest of the universe, because these people would not be happy in a atmosphere like that.
So. Yeah, yeah.
All right, well, let's go on to Wednesday's lesson. Wednesday's lesson is the morning star of the Reformation. Okay, and so, John, if you could read Psalm 19, verses 7 through 11. And then Pastor Nelson, Psalm 119, 162. And then again, back to you, Sean, Jeremiah 15, 16.
Okay. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Amen.
Yeah.
I rejoice at your word as one who finds great treasure.
So what's the purpose of the law? Mm-hmm. The purpose of the law is something that allows us to see God, but also allows us to have just this amazing blueprint for the ultimate in giving society. Because God is loved and respected, then people are loving and respecting with each other.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah. I really like
that. I don't mind that.
Yeah. So go ahead and read your thought, and then I'm going to jump in with what you shared there.
All right. So it is
Jeremiah
15, 16.
Yep.
Your words were found, and I ate them. And your word was to me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts.
Amen. Okay. So just going back a little bit what you said there, you know, and what's the purpose of the law? And like it says in Psalm 19, verse 7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Yeah. And then we go to Paul's writings, though. He tells us that the law of the Lord can't bring anybody, convert anybody as far as salvation, because it can't help us to become righteous in Christ. And what does it do, though? It points us to Jesus. So I think, so to me, what I understand, there's a law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Why is it perfect converting? Because it shows us our emptiness, our weakness, our fallibility, that we realize that through that perfect law, I can't measure up. And so it converts me by realizing I've got to look outside myself, and there's only one place to look that is for salvation, that's through Jesus.
Right. Yeah. Well, and then the other thing is that when we receive Jesus and our hearts are open to God, the Holy Spirit comes in and writes the principles of that law on our heart. And then that is the implanting of the law in the heart.
Amen.
Is what brings about a transformation in our lives.
Mm-hmm. I like how you tied that.
Only the Holy Spirit can do that.
Really good. Right? I like that.
And the thing is, there's a question that's asked, then where does my help come from? Mm-hmm. My help comes from the Lord,
that's
the maker
right.
of heaven and earth, and his representative, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Right. And then the rest of that verse 7 there says, the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Mm. You know what? That the greatest wisdom we can have is knowing God. David even says that in Psalm 119. You know, I'm wiser than all my teachers, he says in Psalm 119. Why is he wiser? Because he has the word of God. And when you have the knowledge of God, God can teach you more through the Holy Spirit that all the great men of the earth could teach you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how we as simple-minded ones become very wise, because when we have the Lord can impress upon us and bring to us truth and wisdom that this world could never give.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, let's go on to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. And Pastor Nelson, you could read that for us.
You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others. You, therefore, must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Okay, so that should be our desire, too, is to be that good soldier of Jesus Christ and to be willing to teach others to a place that they put their confidence in Jesus, just as we hopefully have put our confidence in Jesus. But we really appreciate you being here with us. And again, hopefully you'll be here next time when we look at the great controversy. that is actually being fought right on this earth right now between good and evil. So hope to see you next time.